Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Scent, A Natural History of Fragrance by Elise Vernon Pearlstine. Narrated by Tegan Ashton Cohan. Preface. Before history recorded such things, people would strew aromatic herbs on a floor, use pine boughs to freshen a home, or blend flower petals in oil to rub on chapped hands as a way to add fragrance to their lives. Today, there may be an aromatic candle or two, fragrant lotion, perfumes and potions, and even scented toilet paper. Gardeners value aromatic plants, waiting impatiently for their fragrant lilacs to bloom, and nearly everyone will bury their nose in a bouquet of flowers to get a sniff of the floral and green. Visit any bookstore, and you will find books about gardening, even gardening for specific interests or regions. There are also an increasing number of books on the behavior of plants, how they respond to each other, attract pollinators, and interact with their environment. You can find blogs and books about perfumes and fragrance. What ties these themes together are aromatic chemicals called plant secondary compounds that play a role in the protection, pollination, behavior, environmental response, and health of plants. Blending story and science, this book will take you through history and around the world to investigate the smelly molecules that plants produce and how they have affected our world. Although we love our fragrant plants and their products, humans have played a minor role in the evolution of aromatic compounds, also called volatile organic compounds, or VOCs. It is the moth, the bee, the beetle, the bat, the fungus, and the microbe that have driven evolution in plants to give us ingredients for perfume, incense, potions, and medicine. As a perfumer and naturalist, I have found the inspiration to research and write this book through my appreciation for scented plants and their tiny friends and enemies. The Natural History of Fragrance involves tales of incense, spice, gardens, and perfume. From frankincense to jasmine, plants show us their relationship with humans and the world around them through the functions that aromatic chemicals play in flower, leaf, and seed. Environmental characteristics, often called terroir, influence the volatiles that a plant produces, and this book places familiar scented plants and their products in the soil of their homeland. History has turned on aromatic products such as incense and spice, and industries have been built on fragrant ingredients. Ancient and modern global patterns of trade and manufacturing provide context and contrast with the intimate experience of smelling a flower from your garden, cooking with spices, or perfuming your personal spaces. Fragrance perception is a difficult thing to quantify, very personal, and one of the senses for which we have few descriptors. For the plants in this book, I have included descriptions of scent that are derived from my knowledge of plant essential oils and extracts, gained from years of comparison and contrast to build my scent memory, as well as from descriptions that can be found in the literature. Not everyone smells things the same way, and my goal is to provide some groundwork on how to experience and describe a scent, and to show you a way to smell, describe, and enjoy the fragrant world that surrounds us all. Writing about volatile organic chemicals involves naming and describing the molecules that influence a plant's interaction with the world. Depending on your interest, you may want to treat the constituents in the book as tools the plant uses, or you may be interested enough to learn more about the chemistry behind the fragrances. Using plants as medicine is a practice as old as time and the subject of much current research. But aside from a few instances, I have chosen to limit discussion of medical uses to keep the focus on fragrance. Although we did not cause the rose to breathe out scent or the frankincense tree to shed fragrant tears, Our stories are intertwined and mediated through the plant secondary compounds that we call fragrance. Released from damaged leaves, delicate petals, resinous trunks, green stems, pollen, nectar, seeds, and leaves. Plant volatiles are made in response to pollinators, predators, and pathogens. Apart from a small percentage of plants bred for scent, the smells we appreciate and use are created neither by us nor for us. To tell the story, my tale will follow the history of our use of aromatics from ancient times to modern day, with themes of spirituality and mysticism, power, revolutions and control, gardens, and fragrance as perfume, industry, and fashion. For people, the story begins with mysticism, and with scented smoke rising to the heavens, taking its sweet smell as a message to the gods. Resins such as frankincense, myrrh, cannabis, and copal, and woods such as sandalwood and agarwood, have a long history of use for incense and trade. Molecules from the wood of trees are complex. They are often large, they are healing, and they are greatly valued in perfumes, traditional medicine, and religion. Resins smell of pine, lemon, freshness, and terpenes, smaller molecules that can be experienced in woodland walks or the rising smoke of incense. Small enough to fit into little bottles on a kitchen shelf, and yet with a huge fragrance, spices have had a worldwide influence on trade and exploration. There was a time when the mysterious sources of such spices as pepper, clove, nutmeg, ginger, and cardamom were the subject of secrecy and legends. Explorers followed those elusive hints to find the sources and help establish empires and create vast wealth. Spices are the flowers, fruit, bark, roots, and seeds of herbs, vines, and trees, each producing characteristic fragrances and tastes from a suite of molecules that are often antimicrobial and protective in nature. Their habitats are the warm woodlands and remote islands of the world. Gardens are a home for the herbs, roses, and flowers that make perfume for their pollinators. But their perfume also attracts us, so that we surround ourselves with their beauty and fragrance and tend them carefully. People, it seems, have always had gardens, and gardens have always been as varied as the people who planted them. Herb gardens are often simple in their construction, and their purpose is straightforward: to grow lavender, rosemary, and other scented plants for healing and cooking. Wealth, on the other hand, provides for grand gardens and rich displays of plants and patterns, providing a place to retreat, smell the flowers, and exclude the outside world. Plant hunters have always sought out the unusual, some of which are now found in botanical gardens around the world. That iconic garden flower, the rose, has a long and complicated history, and some thrive outside our gardens in the wild and around old buildings. A book about fragrance would not be complete without the story of perfumery and the extraction of scented compounds for the purpose of beauty and attraction. Flowers are masters of creating and blending fragrant molecules and may produce hundreds of individual aromatic compounds that together create a unique floral scent. A scent that reaches out to moth, butterfly, bee, or beetle, enticing them to come near, sip a little sweet nectar, and, oh, by the way, deliver this little packet of pollen to that other plant over there. The relationship between moth and flowering tobacco provides an intimate example of attraction, repulsion, and protection based on these volatile molecules. In the south of France, a city called Grasse grew in the limestone mountains near the blue Mediterranean Sea, where lavender was found and jasmine thrived. Perfumes constructed of fresh citrus, floral hearts, and musky woody bases were the foundation of the early business of perfumery and aromatic extraction. Modern perfumes were born at the junction of industry and science, where synthetic molecules were created in the lab. Perfumers began using them to create fantasies, and visionaries such as Coco Chanel saw the opportunity to pair fragrance with fashion. Single molecules and formulated blends took the place of the more expensive plant extractions to give the world the hundreds, if not thousands, of perfume launches seen yearly in today's fashion world. New tools and consumer demand have led fragrance companies back into the field to analyze plants and to use little microbial factories as biological producers of fragrance. The world is at a turning point as I write this. We are in the midst of climate catastrophes and, I cannot believe I am writing this, trying to figure our way out of a global pandemic. As you listen to this book, your attention may be caught by stories of the many small farms and indigenous people who grow your spices, or the iconic and endangered conifers that people love enough to give names like the Senator or Gran Abuelo. You may notice the tenuous balance between temperature and precipitation in the Mediterranean, where favorite herbs and essential oil plants are grown, or the challenges facing forested landscapes that produce the mysterious agarwood. Knowledge can be power, and I hope that listeners will use knowledge gained from this book to help in making fragrant choices. It is also my fervent hope that listeners will take the opportunity to slow down and appreciate their aromatic surroundings, to pause in their walks for just a moment under a tree or near a flower bed, to plant a few scented flowers or herbs in their gardens, or even learn a new recipe or two using unusual spices. Then go out and support a local botanical garden. Help in park cleanup activities, check into using organic gardening methods, and find a path to sustaining the soils, insects, microbes, and plants of this world. This is not simply a book about perfumes and perfumery, but one about where fragrant plants fit in our history and in our lives. It is a book for gardeners, perfume aficionados, fragrance lovers, hikers and walkers, cooks, people who love insects, homeowners who have killed their lawn to grow pollinator plants, and people who sniff everything, are passionate about roses or lavender, or want to know more about natural incense. Perhaps you simply think that plants and insects may have a secret life, and you want to know more about that world. Incense, wood, and resin. For humans, the story begins with mysticism and with scented smoke rising to the heavens. Fire once meant protection against the dark and the scary, but it also transformed wood and resin into the ephemeral, creating an uplifting aroma that ascended to the night skies. Frankincense and myrrh, resin-producing trees, have a history going back to the early Egyptians, who used resin from both in their temples for worship and to preserve the dead. Tons of resinous tears from frankincense and myrrh traveled by boat from their origins on the Horn of Africa and aboard camel caravans from deep in the hostile deserts of the Arabian Peninsula to the rest of the world via early trade routes connecting east and west. The trees, growing slowly in dry and rocky terrain, produce scented resin as a balm to coat injured bark and protect themselves from pathogens looking to infect. On the other side of the world, trees of the Americas produce copal resins that have long been used in worship and mysticism. Age produces beauty in the heartwood of sandalwood trees, as essential oil concentrates in the oldest branches, trunk, and roots, darkening the wood over the years and formulating a rich and precious aroma. To extract the fragrant oil, the tree must die, and the wood must be distilled, often through techniques and tools that have remained unchanged for centuries. Another valued tree, agarwood, from Southern Asia, sometimes develops a darkly resinous heartwood because of infection. Also known as oud or eaglewood, its fragrance is not easy to love, with a hint of barnyard, but also notes of tobacco and leather or even berries. And yet, agarwood is one of the most sought after and valued of aromatic wood products, while being loved nearly to death. Almost all naturally growing trees have been felled. Introduction. Hold the leaf of a lime tree up to the sun to see hundreds of tiny pockets of scent, or peel the fruit for a little spritz of freshness. Take a hike in the woods and put your hand on a large pine tree. Your hand may come away with sticky resin smelling of woods and sunshine. Place scented roses in a vase to enjoy the aroma that fills the room, and perhaps remind yourself of a loved one. Grind tiny black peppercorns to appreciate their pungent fragrance of spice, wood, and citrus. Then take a moment to appreciate the plants that have created these fragrances. Not for us, but for moths and beetles, bacteria and fungi, bees and flies, pollinators and predators. This is the story of how and why plants create and manipulate volatile compounds as they interact with the world around them to attract pollinators, fight disease, turn away herbivores, and heal themselves. It is also a story of people and their plants from around the world that will follow the arc of history and culture from prehistory through the Middle Ages to the industrialized world. On this journey, we will find smoke, faith, secrecy, power, nation-building, wealth, addiction, repulsion, fashion, and seduction. For me, as with many of us, the story of fragrance begins with my immediate environment. The smell of cookies baking, the comfort of a scented candle, rain falling on creosote after a dry desert summer, a pretty pink orchid, and the smell of soil in a fertile garden. My fascination with aroma is intricately tied up with my work as a perfumer. I draw on my experiences and the stories of fragrance to help me make my perfumes, to recreate in some way what plants do without thought. I sometimes start by staring at my little amber bottles full of aromatics, each as familiar to me as my fingers, and call on my scent memories as I create fragrance. At other times, I dip a narrow paper blotter into one amber bottle, close my eyes, and breathe in. Then I add another blotter with a different aromatic so I have two together, building a fragrance piece by piece and breath by breath as I inhale scent and make smell the only thing that matters. Sometimes the ingredients conspire to tell a story, evoke an emotion, or perhaps just fulfill the yen for creativity through perfume. Plants are mostly familiar to us as food, fruits, vegetables, and grains that sustain life. But we also value and use them for fragrance. Although we did not cause the rose to breathe out scent or the frankincense tree to shed fragrant tears, our stories are intertwined and are mediated through what are called plant secondary compounds. In order to live, plants require food and a living structure, to which end they make proteins, fats, and carbohydrates for support and nutrition. Because these primary compounds are necessary for essential life functions in the metabolism of a plant, this is where a plant focuses most of its energy and resources. These molecules may also be manipulated to form scented compounds, one example of which is the transformation of colorful carotenoids into violet-scented molecules called ionones. Secondary to growth and nutrition are other critical life processes such as reproduction and disease resistance. Plants are unable to relocate to find a mate or avoid disease. And so, they release fragrant chemicals into the air from flowers to attract pollinators, or volatile molecules from damaged leaves and stems to deter predators, resist disease, and heal tissues. This really means that it is the moth pollinators, the little insect predators, and the bacterial and fungal diseases, not humans, that influence fragrances in plants. With the exception of a small percentage of plants bred for scent, the smells we appreciate and use are created neither by us nor for us. We have, however, valued the scent and healing properties of plants since humans first chewed on a mint leaf or used branches from an aromatic pine tree to make fire. 1. The torchwoods, frankincense, myrrh, and copal. Small and gnarled, often showing its age, the frankincense tree grows in an Arabian desert wadi, where water occasionally flows in the winter. Its bark is papery and peeling in places. On it, a tiny beetle is trapped in resin, and the trunk glistens where it is coated with the sticky stuff. Farther below, there are small drops like liquid tears that turned solid as they traced a path down the trunk. If you were to put a hand on the tree, you might come away with a bit of scented resin softened by the hot sun into a sticky patch. The scent is resinous, but also lemony and soft and subtly appealing. Resins are produced and secreted in specialized structures on the surface of a plant or within its tissues. Sap, by contrast, circulates throughout a plant, carrying water and nutrients. Resins are also characterized by the presence of volatile chemicals. The most abundant are called terpenes, and may be important to a plant's interactions with the world around it. Generally produced within the trunk of a tree, resins may also exude from leaves, new growth, cones, or flowers in a sticky, somewhat liquid form, and they vary in hardness and such other physical qualities as stickiness, color, and fragrance. Many plant groups have evolved to produce resins that may have similar constituents but are blended differently to serve a variety of purposes, from defense against herbivores and disease to providing a layer of protection against desiccation and damaging ultraviolet light. Conversely, resins may attract pollinators and other animals that use the sticky substance for protection, nest building, or shelter. Frankincense and myrrh trees both exude resins from their trunks in the form of tears. Frankincense tears come in colors ranging from nearly white to a lovely green, to a dark amber color, while myrrh resin is almost always a transparent brown. The fragrance of frankincense is resinous, with hints of citrus or flowers, while myrrh is more bitterly medicinal, but with a mysterious richness. On the other side of the world, close relatives of frankincense grow in the tropical forests and deserts of Central and North America to produce a similarly scented fragrant resin called copal. Trees are not the only plants that produce resins. Sometimes a flower produces the sticky stuff, as is the case with the cannabis plant. The stinky, glistening flower buds of cannabis are highly resinous and filled with aromatic chemicals and psychoactive constituents. Hemp, from the same plant, is also highly useful in fiber production and is likely one of the earliest cultivated plants. Its buds and seeds have made their way around the world in the centuries since its discovery by humans. As we learn about fragrance, the how and the why in these sections, we will explore their fragrant constituents with chemical names. These are important because they determine both the response of the plant to environmental challenges and the fragrance that brings value to human society. In resin-producing plants, fragrance is all about the terpenes. Terpenes, the most diverse class of plant compounds, are the smoke of the Smoky Mountains, the fragrance of a Christmas tree, the freshness of a citrus peel, the highly varied aromas of cannabis, the terp in turpentine, and the sharp and floral notes in spices. Monoterpenes are organic molecules organized around a backbone with 10 carbons, making them small in the world of organic compounds. This volatility makes them useful as both the top notes of perfume and the pungent notes of spices that come to our noses as we spritz or grind them. Sometimes an additional 5-carbon chunk is added to the monoterpene to create a sesquiterpene molecule. Being larger, sesquiterpenes are somewhat less volatile, meaning they evaporate more slowly. They are important fragrance elements in sandalwood and agarwood, and comprise some of the more subtle components of other woods and spices. Terpenoids are regular constituents of resin in plants, and are a means by which plants interact with the world around them. Often, the name of the molecule hints at its fragrance. Pinene is found in conifers like pine trees, but also in spices like black pepper, cardamom, and allspice. In herbs such as basil, dill, lavender, rosemary, and fruits such as blackberry and citrus. Limonene is pretty much the pure smell of citrus and, to some people, the smell of household cleaners. A huge presence in most citruses, limonene is also found in many spices, fruits, and evergreen trees. Myrcene is also found in spices, citruses, eucalyptus, and herbs. It has a fragrance that can be described as spicy or herbal, balsamic, meaning resinous but also sweet vanilla in scent, and even slightly rosy. There are many more terpenes, but these few show up often and across a variety of plant and plant parts, where they may repel herbivores or attract predators to eat the herbivores, but will also blend into the fragrance of a flower. Sesquiterpenes are slower to evaporate and arrive at our nose and provide the complex scent of woody fragrances. The highly complex fragrance of resinous agarwood is a product of more than 150 aromatics, some being sesquiterpenes. And sandalwood develops its scent not as a resin, but as heartwood that accumulates sesquiterpenes, giving it a charismatic, precious wood fragrance that is buttery and yet animalic. Here we begin the story of volatile molecules and the plants that produce them, the where and the why of plant aromatics, and the diversity of plant mechanisms, life stories, habitat, and relationship behind the scent. Because this story is also about people and the influence of fragrance on our history and civilization, there will be tales of humans, roads, religion, ritual, smoke, perfume, and incense in narratives that are as old as time and as wide as the world. Frankincense trees in the genus Boswellia grow in the coastal areas of the Arabian Peninsula and are the most famous members of the Bursaceae, or torchwood family. Sparse forests of these trees grow among rocks and sand at the southern tip of the Arabian Peninsula, where monsoon-watered mountains meet dry desert habitats, and they make do with very little. The gift of scent these ancient trees return from their stark habitat is highly sought after and held sacred by many. Highly valued throughout history, frankincense as a trade good was tied to domestication of the camel and development of the incense road through the Arabian Peninsula, which brought currency, goods, and progress to the region as early as 1500 BC. The name frankincense reminds us that it is the very definition of incense. It derives from the old French, franc encens, which means pure incense or pure lighting. Aromatic compounds in the resin are produced within the plant's tissues. Protective in nature, they help resist infection by fungus, repel attacks by insects, prevent desiccation, and seal injured tissues. The resin of frankincense is generally light-colored and leaks as tears that flow for a bit and then harden and solidify around wounds in the bark of the tree. When you first experience frankincense tears, a typical resin odor may overwhelm the other constituents. But if you can get your nose to bypass those fragrances, you can perceive a variety of fresh, citrusy, and even floral notes. The best way I have found to get the full effect of the fragrance is to gently warm the tears so they melt and perhaps smoke a bit, but not to the point of burning. Hojari or Omani frankincense, from Boswellia sacra in Dhofar, is a lovely light green or lemon-colored resin. These high-quality tears have a classic frankincense, woody resinous fragrance, but also a fresh sweetness and earthiness layered on top of amber. One of my favorites is Madi, or B. Freriana, from Somalia. It is golden amber in color and has a pronounced fresh and lemony fragrance interwoven with the typical frankincense aroma. Another species, B. papyrifera, comes from Somalia and the Horn of Africa and is used by the Catholic Church in its incense. Another resin similar to frankincense is myrrh. There are many species in the genus Camphora, but it is C. myrrha that is generally used in medicine and to produce essential oils. Myrrh trees grow in the same habitats as frankincense, also produce a healing resin, and were a valuable trade item along the incense route. The dark, amber-colored resin may be used in the same blends with frankincense and as an important ingredient in incense, perfumery, and traditional medicines. Myrrh shares much of its history, ecology, and uses with frankincense. The fragrance of myrrh essential oil is warm, spicy, somewhat balsamic, and medicinal. For a unique and amber touch, myrrh is lovely in perfumes, but its primary uses are as a companion for frankincense in incense and as a traditional medicine for the skin and mouth. Frankincense trees may look scruffy, but their flowers are sweet-smelling, and the resin that weeps from the trunk and stems has been deemed more precious than gold. They grow naturally along the coast of the Arabian Peninsula and in sub-Saharan Africa. To find them, you would have to hike the wadis of the Arabian Peninsula and scramble out onto the dry and rocky limestone cliffs and hills that surround the mostly dry watercourses. Across the waters of the Red Sea and Gulf of Aden, in the poor soil and steep hillsides of the Horn of Africa, you would clamber along another rock-strewn landscape to find similar sparse dry forests where frankincense and myrrh trees establish themselves. These hardy species take nutrients from the soil and combine them with scarce rain and desert breezes to create something precious and healing. Tears for our rituals, and support for local communities who harvest the resin for the rest of the world. Eritrean and Ethiopian frankincense trees, including Boswellia papyrifera, grow to around 30 feet tall. These are the resinous trees sought out by ancient Egyptians, and the area around Eritrea is thought to be the mysterious land of Punt that was their source. In these harsh environments of rocky soils and little rainfall, the trees produce the highest quantities of aromatic resins after they are about 8 years old. Frankincense leaves are green and curled, emerging in the spring as clusters at the ends of branches. The bark is papery and thin, peeling from the multi-stemmed trunk anchored by a swollen base that secures the tree to steep cliffs and rocky slopes. Leaves fall at the beginning of the dry season, and sweet-smelling flowers bloom just before new green leaves bud out in the early spring. Native pollinators love the trees, and local honeybees will visit the flowers for pollen and nectar, producing good quality honey. Trees seem to do best in harsh, rocky habitats. In good conditions, if left alone and protected from fire and grazing livestock, they seed profusely and regenerate well. However, overuse and other pressures negatively affect natural populations. Goats and camels graze on them. Long-horned beetles bore into their trunks. Local inhabitants clear the land for agriculture. And resin collectors sometimes overharvest, all to the detriment of the trees. As frankincense has grown in popularity and harvesting increases, scientists are raising concerns about sustainability. In some places, trees are not maintaining healthy populations as a result of these pressures. But some studies also show the potential for supporting populations of frankincense by establishing cattle enclosures and fire breaks and tapping the trees sustainably. The resin is an important source of income for many local harvesters by way of foreign cash for countries producing frankincense and myrrh. Across the Gulf of Aden, along the coast of Yemen and Oman, Boswellia sacra grows just inland from rich coastal cloud forests of the southern Arabian Peninsula. To understand its distribution, we begin our investigation of vegetation and rainfall patterns at the coast and move inland. We learn that between March and October, a monsoon wind comes off the Indian Ocean and blows over the peninsula. This sea breeze cools as it rises, and when night falls, it brings high levels of humidity, giving rise to dense fog banks that hover just above the higher ground. Moisture leaves the air, either condensing on vegetation to drop slowly to the ground in thirsty roots, or gathering to form a kind of fog precipitation. Frankincense trees grow in the moist areas but produce low-quality tears. Farther inland, drier, hillier regions are interspersed with wadis. Behind the cool, moist highland, beyond the reach of the precipitation providing fogs, but where cool winds sometimes blow, are the wadis and dry forests that support the most sought-after frankincense tears. The town of Salalah, in the Dhofar region of Oman, will serve as a reference point for a bit of geography. Salalah is located nearly in the center of the southern end of the Arabian Peninsula. A healthy population of bee sacra grows in an area called Al-Muqsayel to the west and in the Wadi Daka area to the north, both dry scrubland habitats backed by the green mountains of the coast. Frankincense trees here have a lovely branching architecture with umbrella-like crowns and are happiest growing along lonely stone outcrops and clinging tightly to solid rock among periodically flooded valleys called wadis. Wadi Daka is protected as a natural park and included by UNESCO among Oman's World Heritage Sites as the Land of Frankincense. Throughout the region, frankincense trees are an important component of the semi-desert areas and, as an integral part of the local ecology, could be called a keystone species. Populations are declining here, as in Africa, possibly due to similar challenges such as grazing by goats and dromedaries and cutting for firewood. In addition, temperatures are rising and rainfall is decreasing due to climate change. Because the trees in this region grow in an area tenuously balanced between wet and dry, small changes in temperature and rainfall may narrow or eliminate these habitats. Once harvested, the aroma of frankincense resin is best released with heat and fire, and may have reached the noses of early humans via a simple fire for heat or cooking. It is easy to imagine a small group gathered around a fire constructed of frankincense wood for companionship and safety. The fragrant smoke would only have enhanced those emotions. Anyone who has enjoyed a campfire knows that smoke lingers on the body, hair, and clothing of those sitting around the fire, which, if the smoke is pleasantly aromatic, may have been a good thing in the days before regular bathing. Before long, I would imagine, the precious tears would have been gathered separately to be used for their fragrance. The word incense often refers specifically to frankincense, but may also be used for other fragrant woods and resins, or for specific blends that may include spices, dried leaves, flowers, roots, and other aromatic materials like ambergris that release a pleasant scent when burned or heated. From its first use, humans seem to have recognized the rising of scent from incense both pleasant and evocative, as a prayer or communication with gods thought to be living on high. Incense could carry messages upward, could purify holy spaces, and could give people a focus for meditation and ceremony. Egyptians were famous users of fragrant materials, whether to scent and preserve dead bodies as mummies, to use as a perfume in the form of an unguent, ointment or salve often made with oils or fats, or to burn as an incense. Frankincense and myrrh were common ingredients in the Egyptians' aromatic tool chest, and both were used to preserve mummies. Ancient Egyptians mainly used oils or fats as the base for their perfumes, oils for liquid and solid fats to make unguents. The most listed ingredients in unguents and perfumes include frankincense and myrrh, cinnamon and cardamom, iris and lily, mint and juniper, and other ingredients both locally available and imported. In a process referred to as maceration, chosen ingredients were added to fats in a particular order and for specific lengths of time to control the strength of the fragrances. The Ptolemaic Temple of Edfu has extensive records on the walls of what may have been a perfume laboratory, or perhaps a storage room, that seemed to be recipes for a commercial preparation of scented materials. Perfumed oils were used to anoint deities, given as gifts, and left in the tombs of royalty. The wealthy and royal also used solid perfumes stored in elaborate containers and were sometimes illustrated as having cones of fragrant unguents on their heads that would melt with body heat, releasing the fragrance. Made from the pure resin or sometimes blended with other fragrant ingredients, incense in Egypt was burned ritually according to prescribed schedules. Frankincense in the morning, myrrh at noon, and the sacred blend called kifi at night. There are many recipes for making kifi, but they all seem to share raisins and wine, fine resins such as frankincense and myrrh, spices, grasses, conifers, and mastic bound together by ritual. The perfume of the incense connected kings with the realm of gods. In a crossover between religion, meditation, and medicine, kifi was used as a cure for snake bites, possibly in a potion, and as an antiseptic, an aid to vivid dreaming, and a sacred component of holy ritual. Trade in the Old World had its cradle in the land of Mesopotamia as long ago as 3000 BC. From their home between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers, Mesopotamians could exchange goods with their neighbors by land and sea. We can be fairly sure that by 1500 BC, a series of caravan routes through the hostile Arabian Peninsula brought incense from the south, where frankincense grew, to intersect with routes of traders that passed through the Fertile Crescent and eastern Mediterranean. As time went on, boats plied the Persian Gulf and the Red Sea to exchange goods from China, the Near and Far East, and southern Arabia to Mesopotamia and Egypt. Silk from China and horses from the nomads of Mongolia were early trade items as Far Eastern traders forged paths between mountain and desert to establish the routes that came to be called the Silk Road. At the other end, land routes from the Mediterranean began as a network of roads from Anatolia, extending as much as 1,600 miles to connect with the Silk Road. By around 200 BC, Arabians were bringing incense up from the south and Chinese were traveling the Silk Road. Greeks were sailing through the Red Sea and across the Arabian Ocean toward India by hugging the coast. In about 100 BC, a Greek sailor discovered, or rediscovered something African and Indian sailors already knew, a faster way to India and its spices. The pattern of the monsoon winds that pushed sailing ships eastward toward the Malabar coast in the summer and back to the southwest in the winter. With Greek sailors stitching together the sea routes, ports were developed, routes were refined, and countries from Sri Lanka to Yemen and Persia to Africa moved spices, incense, and silk by sea and land on the incense and silk roads. In their ongoing quest for fragrant materials, early Egyptians traded in frankincense and myrrh. Queen Hatshepsut, who reigned during the 15th century BC as one of only three female pharaohs, organized an expedition to the fabled Land of Punt, possibly located in the area of Eritrea and Somalia, in search of resins. Afterward, she ordered a temple built in Deir el-Bahari, on the west bank of the Nile opposite Luxor, as part of her legacy. Hatshepsut's temple is considered one of the wonders of ancient Egypt, and the beautifully detailed bas-reliefs of the expedition are the finest in the temple. In them, you can see huts on stilts surrounded by date palms and fragrant trees that may be frankincense or myrrh. The hieroglyphics are so detailed that scientists have identified fish in the streams, and you can see goods such as precious resins, myrrh saplings, animals, and gold. It was not long before the Land of Punt became a mythical place, no longer visited, and its location a deep secret. Humans' love affair with frankincense began long ago. Ancient inhabitants of the Arabian Peninsula and the Horn of Africa certainly recognized the beauty and sacred nature of tears of the frankincense tree and incorporated them into medicine, life, and ritual. Frankincense and myrrh made their way to the outside world early in history and formed the foundation of the incense road. Once traders discovered frankincense and myrrh, they made every effort to bring them out from the harsh deserts of the Arabian Peninsula. The domestication of the camel in 1500 to 1200 BC allowed the incense trade to grow. Due to their adaptability to the extreme conditions of the deserts of the Arabian Peninsula, camels were the perfect desert bearers of heavy loads of fragrant incense, progressing from oasis to oasis and assisting in the creation of inland kingdoms. By 1000 BC, frankincense was known and valued in Babylon, Egypt, Rome, Greece, and China. The movement of frankincense along the incense road, especially at its height between 300 BC and AD 200, was one of the most important trading activities of the ancient world and was responsible for the construction of cities, forts, and irrigation systems in the harsh desert. Because of the high demand for frankincense, kingdoms of southern Arabia connected with India, the Mediterranean, and the Silk Road. By the 2nd century AD, southern Arabia was shipping more than 3,000 tons of incense each year to the Mediterranean world. Even as they were trading by sea, Arabian traders sometimes stored their best aromatics inland in cities protected by hostile stretches of deserts such as Petra, in modern-day Jordan, where they were less vulnerable to thieves. Knowing the high value of their product, traders in frankincense guarded their secrets with legends about the mysterious trees. Said to be protected by large and fierce red snakes that would leap into the air to attack any intruders, the trees were believed to grow in an area of disease and epidemics, making them dangerous to harvest. Or, in a different story, the mythical phoenix was said to nest in branches of the tree and feed on its tears. At an ancient oasis, one of the stops on the trade route, the lost city of Ubar flourished during the incense trade. Referenced in the Quran and called by Lawrence of Arabia the Atlantis of the Sands, this city cast a spell that lasted centuries. Trade through Arabian cities and oases prospered until the Greeks discovered a way to bypass the long and dangerous land route through the peninsula to sail the Indian Ocean, laden with incense. The character, Sinbad the Sailor, may have been based on merchants who sailed around the Arabian Peninsula and traded in frankincense. Sinbad's adventures appear in the collection of Middle Eastern folktales, 1001 Nights, translated as The Arabian Nights by Sir Richard Burton in Victorian times. Frankincense has also symbolized excess and luxury. The Emperor Nero is said to have burned an entire year's harvest of frankincense on the death of his favorite concubine. Or was it his wife? At the time of Christ's birth, the Roman Empire was importing some 3,000 tons of frankincense each year from controlled supplies in the Middle East. When Alexander the Great was young, he once scattered handfuls of frankincense on the altar to burn as a fragrant offering to the gods. His tutor, Leonidas, chided him for wasting the precious aromatic and told Alexander that when he conquered the lands from which frankincense originated, he could afford to be extravagant with it. When Alexander conquered Gaza 20 years later, he discovered a large stash of incense and sent the now elderly Leonidas a generous gift of frankincense and myrrh. Alexander was, however, confounded in his search for a source of frankincense and never made it through the harsh deserts between Gaza and the southern end of the Arabian Peninsula. The same could be said of Caesar Augustus, who sent 10,000 troops to southern Arabia in 25 BC to obtain the treasures of Arabia Felix, only to be defeated by the harsh environment. For perfume and incense, the best of Arabian frankincense stays within Oman for use by the royal house. The Arabian perfume house, Amwaj, is located in Oman and uses frankincense and other traditional Middle Eastern perfume ingredients to create what it has called the most expensive perfume in the world. Founded by an Omani prince, Amwaj celebrates the ingredients particularly found in Oman. Frankincense is mentioned many times in the Bible and is closely tied with myrrh, also a lovely incense ingredient. The gift of the Magi to the Christ child of gold, frankincense, and myrrh is thought to symbolize his kingship, gold, his spiritual nature, frankincense, and his death, myrrh. Orthodox and Roman Catholic churches of Europe and Latin America are some of the largest users of the Eritrean type of frankincense and use the formula of 10/15 frankincense, 4/15 benzoin, and 1/15 storax for their incense. This blend is burned in a thurible, an elaborate censer that is swung ceremonially to release the smoke and bless a space or sacred object. A censer is a fireproof cup with a layer of sand or fine gravel for holding a specialized charcoal puck. Once the puck is red hot, frankincense, or any resin or resin blend, is placed on top to offer up its sweet and smoky fragrance. Alternatively, the resin may simply be melted in a heater to achieve a less smoky, more pure frankincense experience. As I live a life filled with aromatics, frankincense gives me joy and peace. There is something simple in the sacred resin that conveys the feel of a tree that has withstood the test of time and environment to create joyful and healing tears. For creating perfumes, I work with various extracts, mainly the steam-distilled essential oils, that exhibit the same fragrances but without the immediacy and impact of the heated resin. Because much of the beauty of frankincense and myrrh comes out through heat, I love making beeswax candles using a combination of resin and essential oil. Working with frankincense reminds me that the word perfume comes from the Latin perfumum, meaning through smoke. Frankincense essential oils and extracts are valued for their complex aromas of resin and citrus and the way they enhance and lengthen the effects of woody and floral ingredients. Working with myrrh requires a lighter hand, unless I'm going with a full-on resiny, incense-y blend. I love how myrrh can add sweetness and roundness to woody bases in perfumes. despite a tendency toward the plastic and medicinal, a fine myrrh essential.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.